grande por ti. Y aunque lo intentara, no podría sin ti. Toda mi felicidad es gracias a ti. Y si yo me muero, volvería por ti. Me siento grande por ti. Y aunque lo intentara, no podría sin ti. Toda mi felicidad es gracias a
ti. Oh my gosh. Hi, welcome back to another video. This video will be going very into depth on what having a miscarriage is really like and getting super TMI about it. So if that subject is very sensitive for you, I do suggest that you click off of the video. The first thing I want to say is that if you're watching this video, I know you're either already a subscriber or you're looking at this video because you have searched something related to this and you are going through or getting ready to go through a very horrible, traumatic thing, and I am so sorry that you had to join the club. And I hope that this video just gives you a tiny, well, not a tiny, but a big inside look as to what it's really like, because there is a lot that they don't tell you. No amount of prepping can prepare you, but I hope that you find something useful within this video. That being said, I want to move to the first point of miscarriage. So I want to discuss the difference between a missed miscarriage and a regular miscarriage. A regular miscarriage, your body has already recognized that the fetus is no longer viable, in which case it has most likely already gotten rid of the fetus on its own. Now, in a missed miscarriage, which is what I will personally be discussing today, is when your body has failed to recognize that the pregnancy is no longer viable. So you have to get help from an outside source for your body to be able to pass the fetus or get rid of the fetus. So moving on to my personal experience with it. How I found out that I was going through a miscarriage is when I was getting ready for bed and I went to the bathroom and I saw drops of blood, and I knew that that wasn't normal. So I immediately grabbed my husband and I was like, we need to go to the emergency room right now. And so we went to the emergency room, got all signed up, waited for like 30 minutes. They called us back, took our intake. We explained everything. And then they took us back to our room. And they told us to wait there for a sonographer who would come and get me and take me to the sonographic, like the sonogram room, so they could get a sonogram and see what was going on. The sonographer came in like 5 minutes. Before she even started taking the sonogram, she did inform me that she wasn't allowed to answer any questions within the room. I will mention, a week prior, I did hear the baby's heartbeat. So in that sonogram room, when I didn't hear heartbeat as she tried to look for it for 5 seconds, that was already like a warning sign for me, like, you need to prepare for the worst. And obviously, for me personally, I didn't want to even begin to accept that. So even though there was a small voice in the back of my head saying, you didn't hear heartbeat, you know exactly what that means, the rest of me didn't want to accept that. The sonograph was done. She led us back to our room and she said the doctor would be in a little bit to talk about the results, because she couldn't talk about them. And the doctor came in. They told me, like, the exact words were, I am sorry to inform you that it looks like your pregnancy is no longer viable. And as those words fell out of his mouth, I lost it. Like, the second they fell out of his mouth, I had no response but tears, but bawling my entire soul out. He goes on to say that he'll have someone come in and talk to us and then discharge us, and that I needed to schedule a OB appointment first thing in the morning to discuss the rest of the process. And in that moment, it's a loss for you and your partner. So, but you also know how guys try to be more stronger than women. So as hurt as he was still trying to comfort me and trying to say the right words. And I'm not saying that this is gonna be the same for you, because each person handles things differently. I just kept bawling, and the lady came in and told a story of what had happened to her when she miscarried. And in that moment, I was just so filled with sadness and anger that I didn't do it because I still kind of at that moment had a right sane of mind, but I still just wanted to tell her to shut up because there was nothing anyone was gonna say that was gonna make me feel better. And I'm still bawling, so I took 5 more minutes to kind of try to contain myself for at least a 15-minute ride back home in an Uber. And we got home in the morning. I didn't sleep at all. I just cried the entire night. Morning, I called the OBs. They scheduled me immediately. I didn't even let the doctor talk. I said, listen, I'm not going to believe it until you give me a second sonogram. So he did another sonogram. Again, the same thing, no heartbeat. So at that moment, again, completely lost it. But I came to 100% accept it. And as much as I did accept it, it was killing me. The doctor then proceeds to tell me my options, which, since it was a miscarriage, I either had to get a DNC surgery or do the pill process. Now let me explain the difference. DNC surgery, they just make you an appointment to either a hospital or a surgical center. They put you to sleep, and then they enter your cervix slash uterus and scrape everything out, and then you go back home. The pill process is when they give you a prescription for 8 pills, but you take it in 2 doses. So 4 pills on your first dose, 4 pills on your second dose. And what those pills do is they cause your body to go into labor, essentially. As he laid out these options in front of me, I 100% knew that I could never, ever, ever do with the pill process. Me personally, I could never. I knew that that pill process would mean me holding my dead baby. Me having to look at my dead baby. I understand that that is closure for some people. Getting to hold your fetus and say goodbye is closure to some people. But to me, I already had my closure. When my child stopped breathing, that was my closure. Chose the DNC process. Scheduled my DNC within, I believe, 3 days. And he told me that I would have to fast the day before the surgery. I had to show up in comfy clothes, and I could not use any aspirin before surgery. I went into the surgery that day. When you get there, they tell you to take off your clothes and get into a gown, put the hospital socks on, and put a scrub cap on over your hair. And then they put an IV in your arm. Once you get into the surgical room, they put you to sleep. Once your surgery is over, they roll you out. This is a TMI video, so I will say, personally for me, I don't know if it was the drugs. I don't know if it was what I was feeling at the time. But as soon as I woke up from that surgery, I had not even opened my eyes yet. And I literally cannot tell you the reason. But as soon as I woke up, my eyes weren't even open yet. I just started bawling. Did not even know that it was possible to cry with your eyes closed. Once I got to my room, they were explaining how I had to stay there for an hour to have the anesthesia like calm down. They write you a note so you don't have to go to school or work for like a week or two, because they tell you that when you get home, you still will bleed, you still will feel period like cramps. So after the surgery, That's exactly what I felt, and that was it. And they also tell you that you have to schedule an OB appointment within a week and a half to see that they had gotten everything, like double check it, and also check if your cervix is closed, because they also tell you that after that surgery your cervix is open, therefore you can't have sex for 2 weeks because it could cause an infection, and you can also not take a bath for 2 weeks. And those were the rules. So I scheduled my OB appointment, and I went within like a week and a half. They checked, and like I already spoiled it for you, I will mention that this is super rare. DNC did not work. I had the options presented to me again, another DNC surgery or the pill process. The doctor mostly pushed towards a pill process because he did say that having another DNC would probably warrant the same result. So I did choose a pill process the second time, kind of not willingly. I told myself if I had to do it this way, I just would not look when it happened. And I will tell you right now that that does not work. So me and my husband then went to CVS to get the prescription for the pill process. And they tell you that the process will be like a heavy period. Those are the exact words that they use. Like 98% of the time in doctor's office, from what I've heard. And I am here to tell you, it is nothing like a period. And I'm so sorry about that. But sweetheart, I will tell you right now, before I even get into the story, it is an experience from hell. It will traumatize you so badly. You will bleed so much, and blood is different person to person. Oh, and the pain, I will tell you right now, buy a heating pad. That is the only thing that will save you. Those oxycodone drugs that they give you for the pain are not gonna help you whatsoever. So they tell you that these pills go in vaginally. I did not know how to insert pills. Inserting the pills, I thought I would be able to do it like this, but obviously if you go like this right now, you can see that this is kind of wide. And also your fist is not gonna fit up there, so you're gonna have to find another way to insert other than this position right here. So my thing was, I lowered my middle finger to the same size of my index finger, kind of like that, and balanced the pills on top of that and just inserted it. In that moment, you're not sexually aroused, so it's kind of like using a cardboard tampon. It's really dry, not comfortable at all. The cramps hit at about 4 hours, and you were bleeding a lot. And I want to say that your second dose you take around the 6th hour, so nothing was coming out yet. Your second dose of your pills were already bleeding at that point, and you insert the second dose of pills. A shit ton of blood trickling down your fingers and into your palm. So that was traumatizing. And so I kept bleeding for like another hour. Out of nowhere, I felt an immense pressure. Something in my body said, you're not gonna make it to the bathroom. Cup your hands and just grab it. And that saying where it's like something so bad that you can't look away is really true. And I did not see that until that day. Because like I said, my plan was never to look at it, but as it happened, there's nothing you can do but instinctually look at it. The closer you look, the more you see. And what I was seeing was a gigantic blood clot, but within that blood clot, there were little veins, there was tissue, little teeny tiny pieces of bone. Like bone fragments. And like I said, that's a whole nother video on emotion, but that fucked me up, seeing all of that. I became a person that not even I wanted to be around after that, because that's how bad this had fucked me up. And so after that, you keep cramping, you keep bleeding. Nothing else was coming out after that. So we're on day two and I'm still bleeding and bleeding and bleeding, but I wanted to take a shower that day. I just wanted to like wash everything away. So I'm still bleeding at this point and I'm done with my shower. And as I get out of the shower, I see darkness coming in from the corners of my view. And it was very weird because my thought at that moment, as I saw like the darkness coming in, I already knew I was gonna faint. I started thinking, okay, well shit, since this is happening at a medium rate, I need to like get out of the shower, put the towel on, run down the hallway and try to get to my room as quickly as I can. I was also moving at a medium pace. I couldn't get my body to move any faster because it was just shutting down. I just got to close the door to my bedroom and fall on the floor. Which was carpet, so at least it was better than tile. But I fainted for like 20 minutes. But at that point when I woke up, I realized what happened the next day. Parents didn't feel like I was safe being alone because they heard that I had fainted. So they made me go to their house that day. And then at like 8 o'clock p.m., there was just gigantic pain that fell over me. And I can't explain it, but it was just a gigantic ass pain. They drove me to the hospital because like, they didn't know what else to do and I didn't know what else to do because nothing was coming out. It was just my uterus, everything down there, and my entire abdomen was just dying. So we went to the ER and they had me sitting there without any pain meds for like 3 hours, just in a bed laying down. And then my dad finally got so fucking pissed about seeing me in pain that he went to go yell at someone to get me pain meds. And when he went to go do that,
I felt another immense pressure in my body, and it wasn't the same as the first time. It was like a, like someone was grabbing my insides and just squeezing the fuck out of them.
So I ripped my IV out and blood starts trickling down my arm, and I ripped the fucking oxygen meter off of my finger and run to the closest bathroom I could find. And my mom's running behind me because she's like, what the fuck? I did the same thing as I did last time, dropped my pants and like grabbed it. And it was more stuff. And I was like, I thought I was done, but apparently not. And so that happened and I wrapped it up in a piece of paper because that was the only thing that they had in the bathroom. And then I handed it to my mom because my mom wanted to go show it to the doctor. That's what happened with that. And then I got prescribed some heavier dosage of pain meds. And then the next day I had to see the OB again to make sure everything was out. I just had to be one of the rarest cases, one of the most stubborn cases. After the DNC, after the pill process, after all of that, everything that came out of me, let me tell you, it wasn't everything. Because when I went to the OB, they were like, oh, half of it's still in there. So I just scheduled another DNC and I was just over. That entire process took like a month. Like I did not go to work for a month, but that's what the whole process was like. And that's it. And I'm not saying that my process will be everyone's process, but I figured since I was one of the rarest cases to where I had to get two DNCs and one pill process, I could at least make someone who only has to go through one DNC feel better. I don't know, this was just an inside look as to what it's like, because it is more traumatizing than what they tell you. Okay, anyways, this video is long enough. Let's go ahead and say goodbye here. I'll see you guys in the next video.